Okay, so may I introduce my next speaker, Professor Philip Sheltons. Professor Sheltons is a professor of cognitive neurology and the director of Alzheimer's Center at VU University Medical Center in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. Professor Sheltons is really active in the field of neuroimaging, biomarkers, and clinical trials, and he has been the national principal investigator for many multi-center clinical trials. He founded and directs the Alzheimer's Center since the year 2000. And in year 2013, he co-founded the Dutch National Plan Against Dementia and has served as the vice chair of the board since then. In Professor Sheltons' presentation today, he will give a latest update on the studies on lipid diet using Phosphatase Connect, which is a multi-nutritional intervention for treatment of prodromal Alzheimer's disease. Let us welcome Professor Sheltons to talk on the nutritional strategy for Alzheimer's disease. Professor Sheltons, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wong, Mr. and Mrs. Chen, ladies and gentlemen, Vincent. It's really, really a great honor and pleasure to be here today and to talk to you about dementia, Alzheimer's disease. And I can only say that almost everything that I'm going to say has already been said by Mia. But that's helpful to sort of rehearse and to be a little bit repetitive. I could also say it's really, really exciting times. And I'm optimistic by nature, or has always been. But there has been this gloom about Alzheimer's disease. Everything fails. 99% of the trials have failed. But actually, you learn a lot from all the failed trials, and I've never, never, ever been so positive and actually energetic about what's happening in research in Alzheimer's disease and dementia in general as we are today. As you heard from Mia, it is possible to find positive effects in trials, and I'll show you that as well with basically nutritional intervention or lifestyle modification, and that is really good news. And the news after that there will be therapies that actually modify the disease. I'm really confident that that will happen. So we are on a turning point, and it's extremely important that research actually drives this turning point. And actually, your words inspired me also. The SEEDS Foundation and private foundations, in my experience, have been extremely pivotal to help this drive forward. More than governments, actually, private foundations can help us to do research that we need tomorrow and not wait 1 year until your grant is approved. And that has been, in my case, extremely positive, and I think in Vincent's case, the same. So what we are going to talk about today is a little bit, these are my disclosures, you can just try and memorize them all, it will be difficult. But it's what we are, it's in the world that we are, and you need help from a lot of sources. What I'll try to do, and I'm a little bit stepping out of my comfort zone. I'm a neurologist, and medical doctors like myself, we are not trained at all in nutrition. I really didn't understand anything about it before I was engaged in these studies. And that's basically wrong. I think doctors need to know a lot more about nutrition. So that's already a thing that I have learned over the past. So I will talk a little bit about the deficiencies we have in Alzheimer's disease, how single vitamin studies have done over the past, and how the Mediterranean diet has worked, and what the studies have shown, and I'll tell you also a little bit about Suvonate. So this is a slide showing that in AD patients, so patients with even early Alzheimer's disease, may have some deficiencies. And you may see on the slide that almost all of what you see on the x-axis, except vitamin B6, has been found to be deficient in AD. So not only vitamins, but also uridine and the omega-3 fatty acids, choline, have found to be deficient. So there is already a reason for patients who have Alzheimer's disease in a very early phase to probably supplement all these factors just because they are deficient, and deficiency, of course, is not good. So outside of whether it works as a therapy, it's also good to really check whether your patient has any deficiency, and if so, to supplement it. And all these meta-analyses show that this is the case. So what people have tried over the years, also because of these deficiencies, to see whether they actually supplement one of those deficiencies could actually help patients with Alzheimer's disease in terms of improving cognition. This is a very busy slide, but this is a slide showing the polyunsaturated fatty acids, so the omega-3, just to be simple, the B vitamins, vitamin E or antioxidants, and vitamin B2 or ginkgo biloba, as you see. These are all the studies, and basically every one of these studies using a single intervention failed. So it doesn't help to eat a lot of omega-3 pills every day for Alzheimer's disease, because it's a single intervention, and I will show you later why this is the case, that the single intervention cannot help. The best studied diet, if you talk about nutrition, is in fact the Mediterranean diet. And it's probably we like it a lot in Europe, and probably you also in China. And it's basically the Mediterranean diet is the diet that the people in south of Italy eat, or around the Mediterranean Sea. It has a lot of olive oil, a lot of nuts, of course, a lot of tomatoes, a lot of that sort of thing. Very, very healthy. And actually, a few of these studies that you see here, and basically Nick Skarmeas, he's from Greece, has been very active in this field, has done a lot of studies, and he showed that if you look at the studies that have been done in the Mediterranean diet, the most of them are actually positive. It favors the Mediterranean diet score in terms of improving cognition, even in early Alzheimer's disease, or even in mild to moderate stage of Alzheimer's disease. So interestingly, the Mediterranean diet is actually positive. It works, sort of, in contrast to many of the pharmacological studies that have cost millions of dollars. This basic diet really works. So this is already an advice that you can give to your patients. And I'll show you a specific study that was published a couple of years ago, in which they tested the Mediterranean diet plus an extra amount of extra virgin olive oil, or Mediterranean diet plus extra supplement of nuts. And both had a positive effect on the mini mental state and the clock drawing test, which is really very difficult. To have a positive effect on the mini mental state, I can tell you, is really very difficult. But both Mediterranean diet variants had positive effects, significant positive effects. So again, proving that in a trial sort of setting, this really works. So why would nutrition actually work in Alzheimer's disease? Would it have an effect on the pathology? Would it affect a beta pathology or tau? You cannot think that would be the case, and it's probably not the case. The one single target that is amenable to therapy via nutrition is actually the third factor that we often neglect in Alzheimer's disease. We always think plaques and tangles, and we stop thinking. But there's a third one, which is actually most important, is loss of synapses. And synapses are the connections in the brain. Are those connections that you make while you're listening to this talk, you make new connections in the brain in order to memorize this talk. And to gain new knowledge, you need more connections. And connections are synapses. And synapses are made from membranes. And the membranes are made from the dietary supplements that you have in your daily nutrition. So synapse loss is an extremely important part of the pathology of Alzheimer's disease. And it occurs, as you can see in this famous graphs, we have added the green one because it probably is very early on in the disease. As soon as A beta starts to change, already synapses are being lost. So this is just a study showing postmortem counting of synapses, counting of the amount of connections, which is very difficult and couldn't be done until a couple of years ago when high-field microscopy. You can correlate this with pre-mortem cognitive tests and finding that loss of synapses is actually correlated very well to the pre-mortem cognitive loss. And nowadays, we can actually measure synaptic loss by looking into the CSF, the fluid that you get through a lumbar puncture. You can measure the neurogranin, which is coming directly from the synapses. So, and it's also interestingly that in AD, this is specifically the case that the amount of neurogranin, which comes exactly free from dying synapses or losing synapses, is actually increased compared to controls and also compared to other dementias. So this is a tool that you can use to measure synaptic loss. There's another one that we often forget, and that's basically the EEG. The electroencephalogram is also a very good indicator of the function of the synapses. So synaptic loss is important. And synapses are, as I said, basically neuronal membranes that are connecting to each other. And a neural membrane is made on a daily basis by you and by me as we speak from all the ingredients that you see here, which is uridine, choline, the polyunsaturated fatty acids or omega-3, omega-6, and a few other cofactors like the B vitamins. This is not rocket science. This is actually coming from a figure, from a publication from a colleague of ours, Dr. Kennedy, from 1957. By incidence, the year I was born, but that has nothing to do with it. But this was old knowledge. We knew this already for a long time. So these are the basic, this is what you need to eat to get into your brain in order to make new synapses. If you don't have this, you will not make synapses. And that's actually very important. So if you are low on all of these ingredients, you will have poorer memory and you will have poorer cognitive function in general. But now the most important message is this. All of these factors are by itself rate limiting for the production of the membranes. So if you remove uridine, or you remove choline, or you remove the polyunsaturated fatty acids, the whole thing will go down. So you need all of these components in order to increase the amount of membranes. So that is the reason why just giving only the B vitamins will not change anything. You have to do everything at the same time in order to increase the amount of synapses. And that is basically the reason why scientists from the United States, MIT and Harvard, Dick Woodman and his group, they saw this graph and they said, we need to put this all together in a formula, and they made this into Fortisyn Connect, which has basically everything that was in that graph, UMP, DHA, choline, phospholipids, B vitamins, antioxidants, all in one, and those are exactly the ones that I showed you in the Kennedy cycle. So this is the basis for this Fortisyn Connect, and it was the hypothesis that it should increase the amount of synapses. And in vitro and in several animal models, it really worked. It did. So it was shown in vitro that if you put in this formula with neurons, they start making new connections. That's what we call sprouting. They make new connections. So the next thing is then you have to test this in individuals. And as we are used to test pharmacological new chemical entities, we do a clinical trial. And as Mia has done with the finger trial, it's just the way you should do it. Randomize people to a control and to an active component. You cannot always do this double-blinded, of course, but in this case, with the food, we could do this blinded. We had the Fortisyn Connect compared to a isocholic placebo sort of formula, and we tested it just like a pharmacological trial in a double-blind, placebo-controlled fashion. We had several studies, the Souvenir 1, Souvenir 2, and the Connect study, and the Lipidy Diet study, as was mentioned. And I'll show you the latest. The Lipidy Diet study is the most important one. The first I showed, the Souvenir 1, Souvenir 2, we did in Europe, and they were basically showing an effect of the Fortisyn Connect on memory, a positive memory influence. Only memory. So the big thing was, this was short studies, 3 months, 6 months. The big question was, would it work in Alzheimer's patients? And would it work over a longer period of time? And that's why a group of European investigators, led by Hilka Soininen and Tobias Hartmann from Germany, came together and said, let's do this as a clinical trial over a longer period of time, independent from the company Nutritia, who made Souvenate. And this is basically the plan. So 2 years of intervention, double-blind, 311 subjects with prodromal AD. And this study started in 2007, and this was just exactly the year where the prodromal AD criteria were formulated and published in Lancet Neurology by Bruno Dubois and myself and a big group. And we said, this is MCI plus biomarkers. This is the earliest phase of Alzheimer's disease, prodromal AD. And these were all prodromal AD patients. So they had positive biomarkers for AD, either MRI or CSF or PET. So we followed them over 2 years, and it was published in 2017 by the group led by Hilka, and you see that Mia is also one of the authors. So these are the results, basically. The first and foremost primary endpoint was the NTB. As Mia mentioned, this is a battery of neuropsychological tests. This was not completely satisfactory. It was not is not significant because nothing happened in the first year, but at the second year, things started to sort of change and started to diverge between placebo and active, not just enough to be statistically significant. But you can see here, if you treat longer, it would probably have. So here we have not enough power to detect the difference. And that is because basically the test didn't move over time. But look at the memory test, look at the CDR sum of boxes, and look at the hippocampal volume. And that is the most striking thing. With a nutritional intervention, with all these ingredients, we actually could lower the amount of hippocampal volume loss in 2 years' time with 26%. 26% less loss of volume of the hippocampus just by a nutritional intervention. I couldn't believe the figure when I saw it, but it's true. I will zoom in on the CDR sum of boxes. CDR is clinical dementia rating. It's basically what the doctor does in the office, having an interview with the patient, asking about the day, and every other things that happen in life, and score it in a box. And the sum of boxes is a measure of cognition in daily life. The CDR is a very important instrument that is used in almost all the trials. And look here, the difference between the active group, Fortisane Connect, and the placebo is 36%. 36% better performance on the CDR compared to placebo. And in the right figure, as you can see here, the effect was bigger in the group who was the least affected. So the higher the mini-mental, the better the result. Again, stating that if you want to do this sort of intervention, you have to be very early because you have a lot of neurons and a lot of synapses that you can save and improve. So that's the reason why you see this. And now, and this is really an important figure, and this has never been shown yet, you are the first to see this almost. No, it's really true, because it was made a couple of weeks ago. And this is comparing the 45% reduction in the CDR, as I showed you in the previous one, 45% less decline on the CDR with Fortisane, compared to all of the trials that have been done over the time with monoclonal antibodies, which are very expensive and very sort of invasive therapies. The only one who does better is aducanumab, which is the aducanumab 10 milligram per kilogram study in purple here. This is an ongoing study with probably one of the most promising monoclonal antibodies we have today. Results will be in 2020, will be final. They have a 48% reduction in CDR in the interim analysis, 45% for Suvonate, and you see all the studies are doing less, and some studies are doing actually worse. They worsen the patient, as you can see here, bapineuzumab and all the other ones that failed are actually doing much worse. And so again, this is comparing very expensive and invasive therapies to just a nutritional intervention. I think it's very spectacular, basically. So recently at the CTAD conference, which is the Clinical Trials on Alzheimer's Disease conference in Barcelona, Susanna Hendricks did a reanalysis using a measure that is now very popular, which is part of the CDR, is now called the ADCOMS. Remember this, you will hear from it a lot more in the future. The ADCOMS is an instrument which is a composite of mini-mental, ADAS, and CDR combined. The best parts of each of the tests you put together and you call it the ADCOMS. And she did an exercise and she looked again at the lipididiet data, extracted from the lipididiet data the ADCOMS, the mini-mental, the ADAS, the CDR, they were all in there, and she made it into the ADCOMS score. And I will show you just, I was in Barcelona, and this is completely forbidden, you make pictures of the slides because it was so secret. So this is the BUN-2401, another very promising monoclonal antibody. And I'm just showing you because the ADCOMS is used as the primary outcome. And you see here there is an improvement of 30% using this antibody on this specific combined endpoint. And look here. If you apply the ADCOMS to the lipididiet study, we see actually 36% less worsening on this specific composite endpoint. Again, if you compare it, 30% on the BAN2401, it's an interim analysis, it's not the final analysis, 36%. Isn't it amazing that you can achieve this with a nutritional intervention? So, to conclude, I think, as I said, nutrition is extremely important and we just don't know enough about it, but we should. And we should actually study this more intensively. I think the Mediterranean diet is something that you can offer immediately to your patients, and we do this as an advice. Single supplements are probably very useless. You have to combine them because that makes more rationale, as I showed you. Suvonate is such a combination, but I think you can think of other combinations, but Suvonate is there now, and it will be tested in other studies as well. It can also be beneficial in other dementias, we think. And I think the effects are amazing in the sense that if you compare it to much more expensive and much more invasive therapies, you can actually achieve already in the earliest phase a lot with this nutritional intervention. I think also what I showed you with the hippocampal atrophy, that it actually shows you that this is a biological valid intervention because something really changes, less hippocampal loss. And I think, and I would actually echo what Mia has said, this is just a part. Alzheimer's disease is such a complex disease, we will never, ever find one magic bullet to treat this. We will need the whole spectrum. You will have to do exercise, you will have to do all the lifestyle interventions, you have to do something about nutrition, and of course we have to remove amyloid from the start. So that will be the whole sort of package that we will have for the next few years as doctors, hopefully, to offer to our patients. And I think that's why I'm so optimistic, because we're getting there. And my time is up, so I will stop. Thank you very much.